Hey ho, and thanks for checking out this video. My name is Dave, and I'm from Hot Shot Marketing, and that's my YouTube channel. And I'm doing a bit of review of a product called Lead Primo. Well, actually not. It's called Mail Primo. Lead Primo is the new one that was just released. And so in this video, what I'm doing is I'm reviewing the one that was released by the same company about 3 months prior to this, I believe, and it's called Mail Primo. So basically, this is a video showing my problems I had with Mail Primo and still have. And I'm just cautioning you to check out every a few features in Lead Primo if you bought it before, I think you have a month to cancel, and just to make sure everything's working, because I haven't checked out. I'm not going to go buy another product, Lead Primo, and check it out. But I have a huge amount of problems with Mail Primo, and they're almost the same. There's only a few differences they put in. I think Lead Primo has integration with Facebook, and I think that's the main difference I see. But there might be one or two small differences. But 90% of the stuff is the same, and even the template looks very same. Okay, so let's. So you can check out Lead Primo, and again, if you do buy it, make sure to check it out thoroughly, because I don't trust it myself, so I probably won't be buying that one. But I like the concept. So here's my Mail Primo login. I'm going to log in here just to show you the problems I have. Okay, so here we go. Now, I've already set up my SMTP sending account, okay, but I'm going to warn you, and if you bought the Lead Primo, I want you to check this out. When you go to settings here and in sending server, okay, you can set up, you can add a server. Okay, so let's say if you clicked on here, add a server. I've already added a bunch in here, but okay, I'll just go to one that I've added. I was gonna use Amazon SES as SMTP server, because it has very good inbox delivery rate. So let's just look at the editing here on that. Okay, so here's the thing. Take a look at my screen, and you're gonna see how to enter the data. This was very hard, okay, to know what to do, because why is that? It's because the documentation was, well, second to none horrible. It was horrible. It is a PDF so you have to enter. This can be anything, this name here, which it didn't tell you, so I thought that's critical. This is not critical. This is critical, the secret key. This is your sending email, and you'll have to have that set up in Amazon as well. So that's a totally thing. That was never really outlined how to do that, by the way. So if you want something really complicated, and if you're not an email expert, this will be a battle for you. And so you get these two keys. Okay, you enter them in, and this would be your sending email, of course, that you're going to set up with Amazon. And this part here, this is also, you get this from Amazon, but it's not in this format. And this is what they don't tell you. I mean, it's like if you don't dot every I and cross every T, it won't work in here. It won't work. Now, I was able to get this to work to send out a test email with Amazon after going through support, and then finally he sent me some JPEGs of how I got to set this up, and even then it wasn't so direct. I had to kind of guess, and I was actually surprised when it worked, so I was just blown away. Okay, it worked. I thought, oh great, it's just, but why wasn't that documented? The only document you have is in the, I think it's in here. Let's check over here. Yes, PDF. This is how you set up the, and some of this may pertain to people that bought Mail Primo. I wouldn't doubt they're using the same, all the same training and everything. It's just that they've upgraded a few things, but I wouldn't doubt that the training's inaccurate too. Like it's horrible. Okay, so SMTP settings. Click here. Okay, so there we go. Okay, so we got our PDF. Now I'm going down here to anything that pertains to Amazon, basically. Here. Okay, so if you have an account like SMTP providers like Elastic Mail, Mailgun, SparkPost, Amazon, okay, that's what I have. Just click on the name and enter API key, and there you're done. Well, if you go back, You see this? Okay, where was I here now? Just click on the name and, you know, API key and you're done. So here we go here. Back to Amazon. Okay, where is the API key? I don't see it. It's a secret key and a secret password. He said, just put type in the name and the API key and you're done. Doesn't say this, you don't have to do anything. So that's totally wrong. I mean, their interface doesn't even match the PDF. Okay, so now let's go to the next huge problem, because I got it working after, you know, hours and hours contacting support and a little bit of luck, I think a lot of luck, okay. Here is, let's make a newsletter. Okay, so let's say I want to send a email out to my list, okay. Now, it did work somewhat 3 months ago, but it never worked with Amazon. It worked with my Bluehost, because I did some configuration in Bluehost as well. And those ones work, and I got Gmail to work. Well, Gmail, you know, it's probably not what you want to use. You probably want to use something more like Bluehost or you know, SendGrid or something more of a you know, really professional outbound server to serve your mail. Okay, I'm not an expert with that, but I've heard Gmail accounts aren't something you really want to use for doing bulk mail. So anyway, let's say we want to make a newsletter. Let's create a newsletter here. This is where the huge problem is. It's a joke because it used to work. Okay, inline editor. Click. Okay, let's give this a name. Test message. One, okay. Subject, test message one, okay. From, and I'll have to enter any name. I'll just call myself Mr. Tester, okay. And I've already got email preloaded there. You can, this is the drop down box, you can select which email you want to use. And then you've got your default SMTP server that you're going to connect to use your email. So these are my Amazon ones. I know the Bluehost one works, so I'm going to use that one. Okay. So here we go. Let's do something here. Let's go to the next screen. Okay. So now I have to pick a template. Okay. Now, so far so good. Everything looks like it's working, right? Okay. And well, let's just take this template. And you notice there's no blank templates here, which is really surprising me. I just wanted to have a blank one. I think you'd have to use that other option on the previous screen there. But okay, let's go here. Let's take this one. Select the template. Okay. Okay. So I'll just call this, just change one word on here. Tester. That's all. Okay. That's the template. One thing about this that I really hate is you can't delete this whole thing. You just can't have a white, you can't delete everything. You're left with some boxes and some stuff you can't get rid of totally. So it hasn't got a good delete feature. Like you can only turn everything off. I'll just show you. It's kind of strange that you just can't delete the whole thing and just have a blank. So you can still have this green piece you can't get rid of, right? There's no delete, right? So, you know, let's say, you know, you want to delete this gray box. Well, you really can't. There's no delete. There's no way to delete it, you see. Okay, so let's just put them all back on. So basically, I haven't changed much, right? And, okay, the only thing I've changed is that word. Okay. You could send out a test message if you want. That never worked for me. But let's go to the next. Okay, so we're all happy. Let's go to the next one. Watch what happens. See, just keeps going back. It went back to the default one. Lost my other one. So let's try this again. Tester. Let's see if I save it. What happens? Type your template name. Okay. Saved template. Okay. Save it. Template saved successfully. Okay. Okay. Now it's disappeared. Where is it? Where's she gone? It just went gone. Next. Where's it going now? No, this doesn't do anything. You see? The guy, Dr. Amit, Well, either one of the Dr. Anita or one of his assistants there emailed me back. Oh, it works on my end. And they even got screenshots that prove that it works on their end. It ain't working on my end. So they told me to try Internet Explorer, Chrome, Firefox. I tried them all, and I even used a different computer. So there's some shenanigans going on there. You know, it's cloud-based software, so what's going on with that? Like, you know, am I the only customer they ever had, and they don't really care that it works or it doesn't work? And obviously, if they can get it to work, they're going into, they probably have a different method of doing it that's totally different than me. They got a higher level of clearance, if you want to say. So basically, I'm sort of stuck. I can't go back. I can't go forward. I can't do anything now. Let's see what happens if I change template. Does that do anything? No. So it's basically just, you know, it's kind of gone crazy. What's this? Doesn't matter. Choose file, connect. Well, that's an hard drive file. So there you go. It doesn't work. And so here's the thing. You want to buy Lead Primo, which is their one that came out 3 months later. I want you to make sure to check the Amazon SES settings. And actually, I was able to get that to Amazon SES to send a test email, no problem. But it wouldn't send out when I actually was able to create messages about 3 months ago. I can't now. And maybe I was giving too much hassle to support and they maybe blacklisted my account. I don't know. I'm only trying to get this thing working. I'm not trying to be a pain. But here's the way I look at it. When the same company keeps putting out, when they put out something that doesn't work for one product, and then they come up with version two just to try to make more money, I kind of have a bad feeling about that, because your first one should have worked, or at least you should have upgraded your old members that bought the stuff that didn't work to something that might work. I'm skeptical this one doesn't work. So what I would recommend you doing, I don't even know how to get out of there. You know where the spot where I showed you the PDF about how to set up Amazon SES? I'll bet you that PDF is exactly the same in yours, and I'll bet you it will not work if you set up Amazon SES, unless you contact support and waste about a week going back and forth until he sends you a little JPEG screen of how they set it up. Why don't they put that in the documentation? Because no one's got time to waste, right? So there you go. The way I'm feeling right now, because I've tried out a few other ones, and there's another company called Omnibox. It's working. It kind of seems like it's heavily policed, which may be a good thing, but it's you can't import your email on it, and when you do a campaign, they sort of manually check it. So it seems like, you know, okay, it's lower cost, but same kind of thing. You know, you don't have that. I think things worked a little bit better with GetResponse, AWeber. And of course, none of them seem to be very good in one way, because accounts get shut down and stuff. So email seems to be getting harder all the time. I'll be honest with you. It seems to be getting harder to get something that actually works in one box. But I'm just hoping that Omnibox, at least their support is better, and they're trying to work through it and fixing up things. So I'm hoping that works out for me. But as of right now, I haven't found any of these solutions, these low-cost solutions, that work really, really well. Like, so there you go. I mean, yeah, they're low cost. Some of these were unlimited plans. The concept was fantastic. Do they work? That's the question you got to ask if you're running your business. And do you trust the people behind it? Because if the people behind it don't support it, or they delete your account for some reason, or just like what's happened to me, my stuff won't even work here now. Like, you get these type of things, dead screens, can't go forward, can't go back. They'll tell you it works on their end, but on your end, it's useless. So guys, share the word with anyone, and if you did buy this newer version, make sure you check it out, because you still have time to refund it. If, you know, like, don't get stuck with it. You know, that this product, I think, came out by Dr. Amit Parikh, and this is the other guy. This other guy and Ben Murray recently made Vid Effects Curator. I guess this guy was one of the guys at developers, I think. And Ben Murray, this guy is Abby, I'm not going to pronounce his last name, you can see it here on the screen, but he made that VidFX curator, the curating video, and then they came up with a 2.0 version. My 1.0 never ever worked. I was back and forth with the support, and I have if you check down below on this video, you'll see links to that too, on that product, that the VidFX curator came out just recently. So yeah, there's a lot of crappy products in this industry, and I'll tell you why. A lot of these reviews, unfortunately, they're done by people. It's kind of like I'll scratch your back, you'll scratch mine. I'll put out a piece of crap software, and everybody helps sell it. And then when you put out your piece of crap software, I'll sell it. Now, I don't want to say it's all bad. I'm exaggerating the point that test it. I bought some good software too, right? But the thing is, the motive behind a lot of the affiliates will be that, well, they can make some money on it, right? So, and they don't have time to check it all out. Even I've reviewed some parts. Okay, I'll try to tell people at least check it out, like do your little bit of diligence, because I can't test out everything. Once in a while, though, I buy some stuff and I really get into it, and then I realize, okay, this is no good. I gotta let everybody know. So that there you go. Sorry about the long review, but I hope this helps you in making wise choice on. If you bought Lead Primo or going forward in the future, just check out stuff because, yeah, even though the concept is great, idea is amazing, does the software work and are the people behind it, do they support it and can you trust them? Because, they got all your leads and everything like that, and, what's, you got to really ask those questions, okay? So thanks for looking. Take a look at some links before, links below this video. I may have some other products that I'm reviewing and other products I'm recommending you not buy, and I'll continue to do that in the future. Just share and like and do all the regular stuff that everybody's supposed to do on YouTube. Okay, thanks a lot for watching. Take care.
We have all heard it. That guy's a snake oil salesman, a shyster, a con. This terminology has become an intricate part of our culture, but where did that term come from? Were there really snake oil salesmen? Did they really sell snake oil? It all began when the Transcontinental Railroad was being built in North America. Chinese immigrants came over, and with them their cures for the aching joints and muscles that they had at the end of each workday. What they used was snake oil. Americans, seeing how well this remedy worked, jumped on the bandwagon, and word quickly spread that this was a cure for rheumatism, joint pain, and other things. The craze soon developed into a fervor. People began snake farms. In the Patriot newspaper in 1885, rattlesnake oil was said to be going for $4 an ounce. By 1891, the Wheeling Register claimed rattlesnakes were going for $25 to $50 each if they were 4 feet or longer. Soon, snake oil salesmen were everywhere, touting the wondrous claims of this cure. They would grandstand at circuses and carnivals, thrilling the audience with their hissing rattlers and claims of the wonderful drug. Clark Stanley was the most famous snake oil salesman and became known as the Rattlesnake King. Problem was, there wasn't much snake in the snake oil. Mostly, it was mineral oil, camphor, turpentine, and red pepper. It did little to relieve the sore aching muscles, and suspicion grew. Even when it was made with authentic rattlesnake oil, it never seemed to match the claims of the Chinese workers' oil. So why was that? It appears when the Americans made their snake oil, it was done with rattlesnake. This was the crux of the problem. It was the wrong snake altogether. In 1905, Collier Magazine did an expose on the snake oil salesmen, declaring them frauds, pushing useless and sometimes dangerous cures. The public was furious that they had been duped, and they led to the Pure Food and Drug Act being passed in 1907. So why did the Chinese product seem so miraculous when the American-made one was a dud? Well, the Chinese used a completely different snake in their oil. The Chinese water snake in Hydra chinensis was used, and as it was aquatic, it ate mostly fish, something rattlesnakes in the desert never do. This made them particularly useful for fighting inflammation. EPA acids or omega oils have been found not only to reduce inflammation, but reduce high blood pressure, cholesterol, and depression as well. Neurophysiology researcher Richard Kunin brought redemption to the snake oil in 1989 when he wrote a letter to the Western Journal of Medicine claiming that Chinese water snakes had almost 20% EPA oil, higher than the salmon at 18, and rattlesnakes had a measly 4% oil. It appears that snake oil was an effective remedy after all. So when we make claims that something is to be believed or not, we may not have all the facts. What we think may be true may be false, and what is believed to be false may actually be true.